Welcome everyone. Today we have the pleasure of having a speaker, Professor Kaushal Verma from IISc. He'll be talking on non-autonomous basins of attraction. It's complex dynamical systems.
So thank you very much for the invitation to speak here at this event. It's my first trip to ICTS. It's a very beautiful campus here. So in this talk, I would like to discuss two classes of domains in CN. The first class is the class of so-called Fatou-Weber-Bach domains. And these are very, very old. As the name suggests, Fatou and Weber-Bach independently came up with examples of these two classes, which I will discuss. And the other class of domains is the class of what are called short CKs. I will write down the definition as we get to that. But the underlying theme between Fatou-Weber-Bach domains and short CKs is that you can think of them as basins of attraction of a certain holomorphic map or even a countable family of holomorphic maps. And the main interest in these domains is that from the complex analytic viewpoint, these are what are called pseudo-convex domains. They are very big in a certain sense, and at the same time, very small also, in a certain sense. So if you want to contrast this with the existing theory of Riemann surfaces, so a Riemann surface can either be parabolic or hyperbolic, but not both. So these classes of domains exhibit a very curious mix of parabolic and hyperbolic properties at the same time. So there is independent interest in studying the function theoretic properties of such domains. So to start off with, I will begin by defining Fatou-Weber-Bach domains, first of all. Is this visible here? Fatou-Weber-Bach. I will call them FB domains for short. So here is the definition. So I will take a domain omega in CN such that omega is not all of CN. Okay, it's a proper subset. And we will say that omega is an FB domain if omega is biholomorphic to CN. The definition says that you have a proper subdomain in CN, and at the same time, you have to be biholomorphic to CN, the ambient space. Now, let's see what happens when N is 1, the complex plane. The claim is that there are no such domains in the complex plane, because if you happen to be one such, then because you are biholomorphic to C, you have to be simply connected, but then the Riemann mapping theorem says that since you are not all of C, you have to be biholomorphic to the unit disk. And of course, the unit disk and the complex plane are not equivalent from the complex analytic. So in the plane, these domains do not exist. For N equals 1, no FB domains. Okay. But it turns out that for every higher dimension, there are plenty of such examples. And the surprising thing is that they exhibit a large number of very, very interesting properties with essentially very little input. So what I want to do is to tell you how these were constructed in the first place. And you will see that the construction has so much of freedom that you can essentially do whatever you want with them. And that is the reason why they exhibit all these very strange, very interesting properties. Okay, so for n bigger than or equal to 2, plenty of them. All right. So there are two main methods to construct this class of examples. Method 1. And I will call this Fatou's method. The reason is, if you look at Fatou's original paper, he gives you one example. He works with a very concrete holomorphic mapping from C2 to C2, and he does a lot of calculations with that, and he gives you this object, which is now called the Fatou-Pieper-Bach domain. Over the years, people have taken this very concrete algorithm which he suggested, and they have axiomatized this. So we'll see one simple example of this. All right, so I want to look at the automorphism group of C2. Holomorphic automorphism group. This is a very big group, unlike the automorphisms of the plane, which can be easily classified as AZ plus B, A not equal to 0. But in higher dimensions, this is very big. Simply because you can create lots of automorphisms by just doing very little. Let's take a look at this map. H here is your favorite entire function, any entire function here. And this will be an automorphism of C2 because this is clearly surjective, because if this is equal to AB, then Z2 is fixed. Because Z2 is decided, you know what this term is, and therefore Z1 is also fixed. And this is clearly injective also for the similar reason. So this is an automorphism. And this suggests that this is an infinite dimensional object, which it is. So this is big, infinite dimension. So I'm going to work with a very specific example. I'm going to look at this map, which I will call H, Z1, Z2, which is equal to Z2, comma, Z2 squared plus AZ1. So here I've just taken the simplest interesting map, Z2 squared, and A is non-zero. So this is an automorphism of C2, it's a polynomial map. And the point to observe now is that the origin is a fixed point. That's evident from the construction. And let's write down the derivative at this fixed point. So the derivative matrix is going to be of the form, let's write it here. So this is 0, 1, A, 0. Yeah. And the eigenvalues of this lambda 1, lambda 2 are plus minus the square root of A. Right? So far everything is very general. Now I will assume that mod A is less than 1. So this is saying that the fixed point at the origin has a derivative, all of whose eigenvalues are strictly less than 1. So you would imagine that in a neighborhood of the origin, your map H is actually a contraction. It takes a neighborhood and reduces it by a certain factor, fixed factor here. Okay? Now what I'm going to do is, instead of going forward, instead of taking iterates of H, I'm going to look at inverses. So So here is the picture. Let me write here. So here is the local action of this map. So it takes a neighborhood U. Let's just take this to be a ball of some positive radius here. And this is shrunk. And what I'd now like to do is to use the fact that since the eigenvalues are less than 1, I'd like to say that this map is locally conjugate to its derivative itself. So if you go back to smooth dynamics, you have the Graupen-Hartmann theorem, the hyperbolic case, your map is smoothly conjugate locally to the derivative. Okay? So one can prove a suitable analog of this. So I'm going to call the conjugacy, local conjugacy as phi. And down here, to make this diagram commute, I simply have to put in the derivative, which is a linear map, 0, 0. So I'm just going to call this matrix as A for short here. Okay. This diagram commutes. And what I'm going to do is define the basin of attraction. Of the map H at the fixed point in the following way. So this is a collection of all points Z in C2, which have the property that under forward iterates, you are actually attracted to the fixed point 0 here. So the limit as n goes to infinity, H to the n of Z is 0. When I write this exponent here, this means composition, n times. And because of this diagram here, I can also realize the basin in an alternative manner. Namely, I look at this should have been the ball of radius epsilon. I want to pull this back. So I look at h to the minus n of the of this small neighborhood. These are going to get bigger and bigger. And I take the union of these as n goes from 0 to infinity. This is my base. This is a non-empty set. It's in fact a domain in CN. All right. Let's get back to this picture here. This is interesting because, of course, you have the fact that H is a contraction and also that H is conjugate to its derivative. Now, the goal is to create a global conjugacy for H, not locally, but it should be applicable in the largest possible region that we can think of here. So, goal is. obtain a global conjugacy. Where, optimistically speaking, I would like this to exist in the entire basin. All right. So here's the picture. I'm going to call these. Okay, so let's give some notation here. So I'm going to call Bn as h to the minus n of B0 epsilon. Okay. So I want to pull this diagram back n times. So I have B0, which is the initial ball that you start with. Then I have B1. I have B2 here. And at each level, I have this conjugacy here. What's happening downstairs? Downstairs, the map is simply the derivative map, which has eigenvalues less than 1. So when I look at the pullback of this neighborhood U by this fixed linear map A, this is also going to expand by a fixed factor. So this is U0, say U1, U2, and so on. So all these are expanding. Expanding by a fixed factor. All right. So now, how do I create the basin? The basin is obtained by looking at this system of increasing system of neighborhoods here. So right at infinity, I have the basin. And down below, see what's happening. I'm taking a small ball here and expanding this by a fixed factor. So I'm going to get all of C2 here. Now, the goal is to get a map like this, from B to C. Right? Now, to get this map, You just look at this diagram. How are you going to get from B to C2? So I first need to go H infinitely many times and then come back by A infinitely many times. So this map psi can be created in the following way. So define, I'm going to first go ahead n times h to b. For each point in B, you have to go finitely many times. Correct. Right. Yeah. So to create this map, you'll see in a minute. Right. So if I take any point in the basin, as you correctly said, I need to go finitely many times. But that number will depend on where I am in the basin. It'll be very, very far. So I need to come forward and then go back like this, that many times, exactly. So in a sense, sort of taking this collection of all diagrams and putting them together here. Right. Okay. So that's going to disappear. That's going to disappear. Yes. So first of all, roughly speaking, what's happening is this. Take a point in your basin B, you're going ahead by H so many times. H is a contraction everywhere, right? And you're coming back by its derivative, same number of times. So if you write down the Taylor expansion for this composition, you will see that, of course, the origin is fixed, and the derivative at the origin is the identity matrix, just by the chain rule. So psi is in fact locally injective near the origin. At least we can say that, right? So psi is holomorphic near the fixed point and is injective there. Okay. Now, I claim that psi is in fact globally holomorphic, and the way to do that is to do a simple calculation, which again relies on the fact that the eigenvalues are less than 1, and you're looking at this composition, going forward n times, coming back n times here. Okay. So I'll not get into the details there. Claim is psi is holomorphic on the entire basin. Not surprising. Also claim that psi as a map from the basin into C2 is injective. This is a globally injective map. Suppose you have 2 points which are mapped to the same point by psi. So take these 2 points, P and Q. You know that after 100 iterations, you will land inside the ball B0. Yeah? And on B0, psi is already known to be injective. So it better be injective wherever you are in the basin, right? So psi is in fact an injective. And at each stage, these are onto maps, psi is also onto. What have we done? So we've actually created this map psi, which is defined on the entire basin. It maps the basin biholomorphically onto C2. There is a danger. You see, I did not say anything about what this basin is. I only said it's a well-defined, non-empty, open set, right? The danger is that the basin could be everything in C2. It could be C2, in which case we've lost the battle. There's nothing interesting which is happening here. And this was Fatou's very interesting observation. Okay? He said that the basin avoids a very large open set in C2. So it's a proper subset of C2. And the way to see that is, come here. All right, so let's go back to this map H. It's a polynomial map. The degree here is 2. Okay. And if you think about it, let's try to understand the orbit of a given point. Okay. So you start at a fixed point Z1, Z2, apply H many, many times. What will be the form of H to the n? Of course, it will be a complicated equation which you can write down. That's not important. What's important is that it takes this point Z1, Z2, which is an ordered pair, and it's actually doing a left shift in some sense. You see, Z2 has become the first coordinate now. Then you have something complicated here. If you apply H one more time, this will become the first coordinate, and then the second coordinate will be something of degree 4. Right? So, at the nth stage, the first component of H to the n will have degree, say, 2 to the n minus 1. And this will be degree 2 to the n. Observation, this has more weight than this term. At every level. At every level. Okay? So, the idea is, let's decompose C2. So, I will just write mod Z1 and mod Z2 here. Near the origin, everything is fine, so I'm not worried about this. So I mark off a little ball there, and I look at this decomposition of C2. What is this? This is the line, rather plane, mod Z1 equal to mod Z2. Yeah. So I'm going to call this region as B minus, and this as B plus. Now, what happens if I start with a point here and I apply H to it many, many times? Look at the orbit. Because of what we just discussed, namely that the second factor always has higher degree than the first factor, the claim is that the entire orbit is in V plus. And in fact, the orbit actually goes to infinity. H to the n, Z1, Z2, goes to plus, if you are in this region. Now, where did the basin lie here? Well, the basin, of course, contains the origin, and it contains all points which are attracted to zero in forward time. This tells you that your basin cannot intersect V plus at all. So, your basin is going to look like this. Complement of B is a very large open set, and yet B is biholomorphic to C2. Now I must say that Fatou did not consider this example. His example was sort of a little more complicated, but still a polynomial map. Maps of this kind have become more interesting in complex dynamics in recent years because of the following theorem. See, we remarked that the automorphism group of C2 is very, very big. So there was a time when people were wondering, well, if we have to do dynamics in high dimension, what kind of maps do we consider? So first of all, they said, let's look at polynomial maps. Yeah. Simplest thing. Fortunately, if you look at a polynomial automorphism of C2, there is a classification theorem due to Friedland and Milner, which says that every such map is conjugate to either an affine map, standard affine map, in the sense of linear algebra, elementary maps. Elementary maps are those that take vertical lines to vertical lines. So you can have a concrete description of those. And the third class, which is very interesting, is the class of Hinon maps. This is an example of a Hinon map. So a general Hinon map has the following form. So H of Z1, Z2 will be, again, you have this shift. The second coordinate becomes the first coordinate. And then I can stick in a polynomial in Z2, and then maybe plus a non-zero constant times Z1. So the theorem says that you are either conjugate to an affine object, finite compositions allowed, elementary maps, or finite composition of maps of this kind. And it turns out that for affine maps and elementary maps, the dynamics is not all that complicated to describe. Everything is essentially known. So these are the maps, and you can see even a quadratic polynomial gives rise to very interesting transcendental behavior. The point that I'd like to emphasize is that The existence of these domains shows that there is no version of Picard's theorem in higher dimensions. Yeah? You can have mappings from C2 to C2 whose range avoids very large open sets. So Picard fails in higher dimensions. All right. Now you might wonder, can you fit in two disjoint Fatou-Bieber-Bach domains in C2 simultaneously? Can you have three? Can you have countably many? Yeah? If you go back to this construction, this only relied on the fact that you have a certain special kind of map and you have some very elementary properties at the fixed point. All you need to do is to come up with a map with two fixed points such that the local behavior is similar. Each fixed point will therefore have its own basin, and no two basins can intersect. Because if they were, anything in the intersection will not know where to go in forward time. Right? So such maps exist. You can write down actual formula for them. But the surprising thing is, if you look at one of Kodaira's paper, I believe the last one that he actually wrote, he gave an example of a countable family of disjoint Fatou-Bieber-Bach domains in C2. Very beautiful example. Very concrete. It's not a polynomial map, but it involves, I think, sine Z1. Maybe that's as complicated as it gets. and you don't really need this to be polynomial. You just need local behavior at the fixed points. So, that paper, you have a countable family of disjoint Fatou-Bieber-Bach. The surprising thing is, if you look at their union and their complement, there's enough space there also. Lot of space there. Another property that I can mention is that, see, one might ask, what is the boundary of B like, the basin? Because this construction gives you no information about the boundary. The answer is, surprising answer, there are ways to construct these basins, not with these polynomials, but little more complicated maps, such that the resulting basin has C infinity smooth boundary. And if you look at the boundary of these objects, you get a real 3-manifold, an unbounded real 3-manifold. And one can show that this boundary is actually foliated by Riemann surfaces. It's a very interesting object. So you can have Fatou-Bieber-Bach domains with smooth boundary. It's not smooth. It's not smooth. Yeah. Yeah. So to get that object, it's not enough to work with just one map. Here, the basin was defined just in terms of the iterates of one fixed map. Yeah? You could also play a slightly different game. Namely, you give yourself a collection of Henon maps with varying coefficients. And you can create the base and assume that all of them have a fixed point at 0, 0. You can create the resulting basin by saying that a point C in Z2, in C2 belongs to B if the limit of Hn times Hn minus 1 all the way up to H1 of Z is 0. So you're not taking the orbit of a point under H, but you are, at time t equal to n, you are composing with the map Hn. So that's the non-autonomous phrase here. Yeah, so the map changes. Map changes. And if you work with the right class of maps, you get these examples. And there are examples where you have not only a countable collection of disjoint FP domains, but all of these are actually translates of one another. This translates. So I take the first basin, translate it by a fixed amount, you get the second basin, and so on. There is this incredible symmetry also. And yet, when you take the union and their complement, there's a lot of space there in the complement. Are, I think, very interesting objects. Okay. so maybe I will do I? So what I'm going to talk about is joint work with two of my former students, Shaini Vera and Ratnapal. So you know, what we did was to try and put this in a slightly different context from the viewpoint of complex analysis. And the story actually goes back to the first open problem in several complex variables, namely the Levy problem. So I start with a smoothly bounded domain D in Cn. And you will see words like pseudo-convex and domain of holomorphy and so on. Let's not worry too much about them. The Levy problem was to show that one definition implies something else about these domains. Very briefly speaking, pseudo-convex means the following. You take your domain and look at a sequence that goes to the boundary. Take some sequence. Your domain is pseudo-convex. If I can give you a holomorphic function such that its values on that sequence blow up. And this should be true for every sequence that I take. Okay, so that's the notion of pseudo-convexity. And domain of holomorphy is simply means that your domain is the largest domain of definition of your holomorphic function. That's what it roughly means. Namely, analytic continuation beyond the boundary is not possible at all. Okay, so that's... This was the first problem, and it took a while for this to be solved. 1942, when this Japanese mathematician Oka first solved this, and in our arbitrary dimension, there were others a few years down the road. And in general, the Levy problem can be phrased as, you know, existence of a strongly plurisubharmonic exhaustion function implies that the domain is time. So again, a bunch of words. Not worry too much about them. I want to come to the third bullet point here, which is a question that was motivated by the Levy problem. Okay. The question is the following. So you have an increasing sequence of domains, pseudo-convex domains, and all of them live in some reasonable space. What I'm going to do is take the union of all of these, so that's like a limit, a projective limit of some sort. And the question I'm asking is, if each omega j has a certain property, is their union also satisfying the same property? See, from the viewpoint of topology, if you look at an increasing union of cells, the union is also a cell in some sense, right? But for this class, the answer is no. The union does not inherit this property of being time. So this was a rather surprising counterexample from the mid-70s. Okay, well, people did not give up hope. They said, well, let's try one more creation. What if each omega j is biholomorphic to some fixed domain? What can be said about omega? In particular, is the union omega also biholomorphic to the same fixed domain? So at this point, I want to draw your attention to what we have discussed here. How did we create this basin for the Henon map H? We started with a tiny ball here of radius epsilon. H is an automorphism of C2, and I'm pulling these back, right? So B1 is actually biholomorphic to B0. B2 is biholomorphic to B1, which in turn is biholomorphic to B0. So we are in exactly this situation. You have an increasing sequence of open sets, all of which are biholomorphic to the ball of radius epsilon. And what is the union? The union is the basin of attraction here. Okay? But clearly the basin is not biholomorphic to the ball. It's actually biholomorphic to C2. So let's keep that in mind. This is what I said. So in general, the answer to that special case is also false. Well, you could try one more variation. instead of the ball is too small in some sense. Take a sequence of omega j's, each of which is biholomorphic to Cn. So an increasing sequence of Fatou-Bieber-Bach domains. Take their union. Question, is the union also biholomorphic to Cn? Answer, surprising answer, no. So many things get messed up when you take these limits. And the answer is sort of very recent. The limit of Fatou-Bieber-Bach domains need not be Stein, cannot be biholomorphic to Cn. Okay, so example two is in the same spirit here. So this was the state of affairs in the mid-70s, people did not quite really understand what was happening in these examples. So there was a theorem in the early 80s, again motivated by the Levy problem. In this case, they assume that each omega j is biholomorphic to the ball, and the additional assumption is that the Kobayashi metric on the limiting domain is not identically zero. Yeah. Now, the Kobayashi metric is the higher dimensional analog of the Poincaré metric on planar domains. Yeah. So all you need to do, so how do you define this metric? So you take your domain, take a point P and take a tangent vector V. So I have to give you a recipe to measure the length of this vector. How do I measure its length? So I look at all possible mappings from the disk, unit disk into my domain, which map the origin to the point P, and the standard derivative here is mapped to V in that direction. Okay. And I see what is the largest radius that can be mapped inside with this property. I take 1 over this largest radius. That is the Kobayashi metric. Now, if you look at Cn as your domain omega, no matter where you are, you can always put in a very large disk. There's so much of space. Right? So the Kobayashi metric on Cn is identically zero everywhere. It's because there is so much room. So the assumption here is rather interesting. They said, well, let's assume that the limit domain omega has a non-vanishing Kobayashi metric. Then they said, is it possible to say something about omega? The answer was yes, very interesting. You're either biholomorphic to the ball or you are biholomorphic to a cylinder, a disk cross C. Yeah. And a similar conclusion holds if you replace the ball with the polydisk in two dimensions. So you're either biholomorphic to the polydisk or to the cylinder, delta cross C. Now it's interesting, you see, the ball, the Kobayashi metric on the ball is totally non-degenerate in every direction, because there is a bound on the maximal radius that you can embed into your domain. Yeah? So K is never zero in that case. Please look at delta cross C. This is a disk cross C here. If I pick a point in this domain, and if I choose my vector to be vertical, I have a lot of room to put in a copy of C. So the Kobayashi metric on delta cross C vanishes in the vertical direction, but not in the horizontal direction. So the rank of the Kobayashi metric here is 1, so to speak, and the rank here is 2. So this was a theorem, or I should say, 1981. And they posed the question, what happens if the Kobayashi metric on the limit domain vanishes identically? Can we classify all possible omegas in this case? Classification is not possible because of what we just discussed here. You can get lots and lots of Fatou-Bieber-Bach domains. The limiting domain is biholomorphic to C2. But yet, there was a feeling that maybe, you know, you see, there is so much freedom in this construction. Maybe something is possible. Alright, so this is where the notion of short C2s make their appearance. So short C2 is a class of domains. I'll define it in CK. So a domain is said to be a short CK if, number one, omega is the increasing union of biholomorphic images of the ball, but omega is not all of CK. Right? So this is sort of like the Fatou-Bieber-Bach case. Increasing union, but not all of Cn. Second condition, the Kobayashi metric on omega vanishes identically. There is a lot of room in all directions from the metric viewpoint. So again, very similar to Fatou-Pieper-Bach domains. The third condition is the most interesting one. There is a non-constant bounded plurisubharmonic function on omega. Now, let's look at conditions 2 and 3. Okay. Condition 2 is like a parabolic property. It is saying that the Poincaré metric is zero in some sense. Kobayashi equal to Poincaré here. So this is like a parabolic property. So omega has to be very big in that sense. But the second condition says that you have a non-constant bounded plurisubharmonic function. This is exactly the hyperbolic case in the theory of Riemann surfaces. Existence of a non-degenerate Green's function. Right? So a short CK is one which admits both parabolic as well as hyperbolic properties. Yes. So point two is like parabolicity, universal cover is C. Existence of non-constant bounded PSH function is like saying, well, you have a subharmonic function which is bounded above, non-constant. This is exactly the condition when you have a Green's function for your Riemann surface. Right? Hyperbolic case. All right. So this definition is not even 20 years old. It's very new due to Fornes. And he gave two ways to construct these short CKs. The first one is not surprising. You again look at a suitable F, look at the corresponding basin. So you might ask, well, in this case, I seem to get a Fatou-Pieper-Bach domain. Why should I believe that this is going to give me something like a short CK? Crux of the matter is, we did not use this A at all essentially, except the fact that it's less than 1. That's about it. Yeah. So what happens if your A is very, very close to 0, for example? Or for that matter, maybe you could look at not just one map, but give yourself a collection of automorphisms, define your non-autonomous basin in this manner, okay? And at each stage, your Fn is going to have a certain coefficient that goes to zero at a certain rate. Yeah? Because this is fixed and you iterate this fixed thing, you get a Fatou-Pieper-Bach domain because you have expansion by a fixed rate. But supposing the rate was not uniform, this is where the interesting thing happens. So let me focus on the second one here. Method A is okay, so I'll tell you method A. Oh, this is method 2, sorry. Yeah. So I look at maps of this form. Fn is anz2 plus z1 squared anz1. And now you have this decay, rapid decay of the coefficients to 0. All of them have a fixed point at the origin. You can compute the derivative also at the origin. And then you sort of define the basin. Yeah. So phi and z's are sort of, you know, some calculation here. But phi less than c, where phi is essentially the composition n times, this object turns out to be a short c2. Okay. And where does the non-constant plurisubharmonic function come into play? Well, you do this. You define this function phi, as I've told you here. Take log of that. Take 1 over d to the n. D is... Now, this typo here, it should be 2 to the n. B is the degree of the map. So take 1 over 2 to the n, log of phi and z, and then you get a limiting thing here. And why is this natural? See, look at phi n. Phi n is a composition of all of these. What is the degree of this composition? Each factor has degree 2. So this composition has degree 2 to the n. So when I take log of that, I get a PSH function. But then I need to normalize. That's why I get 1 over 2 to the n. So this gives you a non-degenerate, non-constant PSH function. And this is simply the sub-level set of that. So phi restricted to this object is the PSH function that we want. So this is a short C2. So this is, again, a very flexible construction. Okay. Let me come to Henon map, something that we discussed earlier. This is sort of similar to what I wrote down here. Again, look at the associated Green's function. Log of h to the n divided by 1, divided by d to the n. That's your Green function. The limit exists, it can be shown. And then for every c, the sublevel set of g is a short c. Okay. So in the picture here, it's interesting. So I have drawn the picture for the basin of attraction. G plus is a plurisubharmonic function on all of C2 here. Okay. Its level set for C positive, every C positive, is going to look like this. So as C increases, this boundary will move up. But they're all going to contain this yellow basin. And this is the surprising part. See, B is a Bieber-Bach domain. It's biholomorphic to C2. And yet, it is contained inside a short C2. G plus less than C. Okay. That's your short C2. Okay, so that picture that I have drawn there, short C2s can actually contain Fatou-Bieber-Bach domains. This is the result of Codera that I had mentioned. There are countably many disjoint FPs whose union is still not all of CK. One could ask, is there an analogous theorem for short C2s? So the attempt was, you have all these very interesting pathological examples of FB domains. Can you create a dictionary between them? Take this result in FB domains. Is there an analog for short C2s? So let me just give you the list of examples of FB domains. Third one, take a complex codimension 2 algebraic variety in C3 or higher. There is a Fatou-Bieber-Bach domain in its complement. So you can avoid all these sets also. Fourth one, take a lattice in CK, and around each lattice point you put a little ball, so you get a collection of disjoint balls. There is a Fatou-Bieber-Bach domain in the complement of the union of these balls. It's very complicated, sort of going all over the place. Okay, FB domain with smooth boundary due to Stensonus. Conclusion: FB domains are rather wild. Attempt is: are there analogs of these theorems for short C2s? So this is the first theorem. So for every 3 higher, you can find k minus 1 short CKs, disjoint, which are contained in CK. And we can do better very recently. You can make this a countable collection also. So there's an exact analog of Codera's theorem. Short CKs can avoid codimension 2 objects. Okay, so let V be such a variety. Look at its complement CK minus V. You can fit in a short CK and at the same time ensure that the short CK contains a Fatou-Bieber-Bach domain. Exactly the same picture that I have here. So you have an object that you can avoid, and inside your short CK you have a Fatou-Bieber-Bach domain. In C2, it's possible to construct a C infinity smooth short C2, smooth boundary, which means I have to tell you what this countable collection of maps are and how do you work with them. Boundary, limiting object has smooth boundary. And in higher dimensions, C3 and higher, you can put all these properties together. So give yourself such an algebraic variety. First of all, you can avoid this, number one, and you can also ensure that this short C2 has piecewise smooth boundary. So I don't know if I can make this smooth everywhere, but it is piecewise. And at the same time, the piecewise smooth, yeah, okay, good. Basic construction, so there's just one last slide on the type of maps that are considered here. If you look at this, this is sort of inspired by the Henon type maps here. You know, I said Henon maps are like maps. Second coordinate becomes the first coordinate. So in higher dimensions, the problem was, what is the right combinatorial arrangement that we want? So this k tuple, z1, z2 up to zk, you see the first coordinate is zk up to a constant. So this is again like a shift. So the last becomes the first coordinate. And everything to the right of it is actually pushed. See, this becomes z2 plus z1, z3 plus z2, and then zk plus zk minus 1. So it's sort of like a circular thing. The last coordinate becomes the first component, and everything moves at the rate of, you know, a certain power plus the one before that. So these maps turn out to have the right, I would say, the right form to create all these objects here. And I've just thrown in these constants, eta n's, and these etas are supposed to decay at a very, very rapid rate. So I fix a constant a, positive constant between 0 and 1, and I have to ensure that these constants go down to 0 very, very fast. So working with these maps actually give you lots and lots of examples. So I think this is still not well understood, at least I don't understand it. So the attempt has been to understand the function theoretic properties of these domains better. Because from the metric viewpoint, there is nothing. There is, even the Kobayashi metric is 0. And every other metric is smaller than the Kobayashi metric. So there's no hope to construct these invariants. So that's where the problem is. I think I'll stop here. Thank you. Yes, yes, yes. It'll be very interesting to ask that. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, see, I have not been able to work with this bounded PSH function at all. I mean, I know there is one such object. Maybe I could look at the family of all possible bounded PSH functions. And try to construct certain envelopes in the sense of Perron's method, PDE, and so on. Does that give you some interesting information about the domain itself? I don't know. I have not been able to play around with that. And as you correctly said, you know, I'm looking at this increasing union just in CK. Well, but I can think of these BKs as sitting inside PK also, and I can take the limit in PK. So what do these domains look like when you compactify them? I don't know. Very interesting. Three manifold, and they are laminated by Riemann surfaces. Yeah, absolutely. Levy form is identically zero. One question could be, you start by analyzing the set of hyperbolic leaves there. Does it have full measure? Look at the class of parabolic leaves. Is there even a single parabolic leaf here? I don't know. And if there is, how big is the set of parabolic leaves? There are some interesting things which... Yes. So unfortunately, no. So I can't give you a defining equation for them. The best I can do is take this Green's function, take its sub-level set. That Green function exists everywhere. I even know what it looks like asymptotically. And G plus equal to C is the boundary. That's the most I can. Thanks.